on correlation times of velocity and kinetic helicity fluctuations in rotating or shearing turbulence.
Can you see my screen? And let me put it in the small one. Is it working okay?
Yes.
And you can also see my cursor.
Yes.
Okay, so yes. So I want to give a brief report on this result of measuring correlation times of velocity and helicity fluctuations. So the concept and the actual calculations of those quantities are actually quite straightforward, but I think there are some subtleties in how to define the, like the definitions and what we really measure and what could be the implications of those results. So this is done together with Navin, and he's, I think, also among the committee of this TensorCode user meeting. This whole project is motivated by this shear dynamo problem. So people have found large-scale dynamos in shear flows with a non-helical turbulent forcing. For example, in this Fitzgerald letter paper, they found that the growth rate of the B root mean square of the magnetic field scales linearly with the shear rate. And at the same time, the scale of the mean field goes down with increasing shear rate. So at S equals one, roughly, this is about five or so. And I think the forcing scale here is 1/3. So this is really a large scale field. So far, there are mainly two theoretical candidates to understand this problem. One is called the shear current effect, and the other is the main focus today, which is called the fluctuating or the incoherent alpha effect. So let me first briefly talk about this shear current effect. So I gave a talk about this during last time, the TensorCode user meeting last year. And the brief story is that there are two possible contributions to this shear current effect. One comes from the velocity fluctuations, the kinetic version. The other comes from the fluctuations of the magnetic field, which is the magnetic shear current effect. And there are different theories to compute the relevant turbulence transport coefficients. There is the tau closure method, and there is also the SOCA or the quasi-linear calculations. And we also have results from numerical simulations using the test field method. And you can see that all those results actually don't agree. You see yes and no's all around. And it's quite a problem. And we had this paper last year regarding how to resolve this, all those discrepancies between theories and simulations. But there is also a later paper by Marit and Axel and Matthias using more advanced version of test field methods. And there's seemingly some disagreements between those two. So there is still this shear current effect is a still a very is a still an open question. But the focus today will be the fluctuating alpha effect, the other candidate. So I guess many people are familiar with this conventional alpha effect. This was raised by Parker 70 or so years ago. So the basic motion of a buoyant a flow blob, it rises and expands and then counter rotates with the background global rotation. And in this sense, it makes a helical motion, and this gives a net kinetic helicity to the turbulence. And so you can derive this alpha coefficient, which is roughly proportional to the kinetic helicity. And there are then growing modes at large scale for the mean field, for the magnetic field. So in this case, this averaging denoted by an overline, it filters out the modes in the flow whose scale, length scale or time scale are much shorter than those of the mean magnetic field. Now, for this incoherent alpha effect, instead of a finite and constant, roughly constant value for the alpha coefficient, we now have alpha itself fluctuates around zero. I want to remind you that alpha itself is a averaged quantity already. So it means this averaged quantity itself has some oscillations. Therefore, if we could further assume that the scale of this alpha fluctuations is somewhere in between the turbulent scale LU and the mean field scale L, then we can perform a second average over the mean field equations. Here I'm denoting this second average by angle brackets. If you do this, and depending on different assumptions for this alpha coefficient, you either get a growth in the first order moment of the mean field, which of course it is itself, or you get growth of its second order moments. So all in order to derive those equations, we really need a scale separation between the alpha fluctuation and the velocity fluctuation. Then the question is whether we see this kind of scale separation in simulations. And can we quantify this alpha time scale? Now, alpha itself is really a turbulent coefficient, and only through some closure models we can connect it to the helicity. So this definition of tau alpha will then subtly different between different theories. For example, there are a bunch of theories which started from the mean field equation, like the usual mean field equation, and put in some stochastic alpha. So in some sense, they're solving a stochastic differential equation. And then in this case, this alpha timescale will be roughly identified as the correlation time of the mean helicity or the total helicity, kinetic helicity in the system. Or there are another class of models using the renovating flow model. In the sense that at each given snapshot, we approximate the turbulence by some shearing wave with random phase and random directions in time. In this case, this alpha time scale will be closer to the correlation time of each mode in the Fourier space. So let me put this in equations, and you can see really what's the difference between those two definitions. So number one, the correlation of the total helicity. So basically, you first compute the total helicity, kinetic helicity in the box, and compute its autocorrelation function. The other one, which corresponds to the renovating flow model, is we first Fourier transform the velocity field and the vorticity field omega. We dot them in the Fourier space. This gives G, which is the helicity density in the Fourier space. I used G instead of H as the symbol because that might get confused with the helicity density in real space. The Fourier transform of the helicity density in real space is different from this G quantity. Then we compute the autocorrelation of this G, the helicity density in Fourier space, and we perform different degrees of average depending on the symmetry of the flow. For example, we do the shear average for isotropic turbulence. That is, we average over the solid angle in the Fourier space. We also do azimuthal average, which is over the azimuthal angle in Fourier space for rotating turbulence, which respects axis symmetry. And finally, we also do volume average. Because of the Parseval's theorem, this volume average in K-space is actually equal to the volume average in real space. And for the, yeah, I see there is a question by Matthias.
Yes, for the possibility B,
yeah.
So the integrand is a function of T and K, and you integrate over phi. What does this really mean?
Yeah, phi, by phi, I mean the azimuthal angle in the Fourier space.
In the Fourier space. Okay.
Yeah,
and you also keep it remains to be a function then of the modulus of K and of theta of the Fourier space. Right.
Yes, or in other words, it's KR and KZ.
Mm-hmm. In other words, yes. Okay, thanks.
And this omega is also in the Fourier space, by the way. So yes, velocity correlations, this is more straightforward. And in similar way, we also perform those kind of averages. So because this is the pencil code meeting, and I want to briefly mention how we compute this correlation functions in the code. So there are basically two methods which we use. The first method, this was developed since last user meeting. And we thank Axel, Jennifer, and Alberto for their help in developing this technique. So the basic idea is that we have an auxiliary variable called UUT. And this variable is updated to be equal to the velocity variable UU every certain time interval, delta T. And this is an input parameter. And after it's updated, it remains piecewisely constant during this delta T interval. In the next interval, it is updated to the velocity field in that interval. Then in each of those intervals, we compute the correlation between UU and UUT. And this becomes the autocorrelation function of the velocity field during that interval. We then average discretely all those time intervals to get the final autocorrelation function. So the advantage of this method is that it's computed on the fly and for all grid points in the simulation box. But it will need a long simulation time to get enough intervals. For example, if delta T is 50 and you want, say, 100 intervals, then you will need to get to T equals 5,000. And at the same time, you will need somewhat small time resolution because you really want to resolve the smallest time scales in the box. So this would require some requirement on the disk space. The second method is more straightforward. We just output the Fourier modes of the velocity field and do the correlation in the post-processing. And in the second method, again, the output is limited by disk space. But since we can do really convolution to this time series, it is good at resolving short time, very short correlation timescales, even if the output time interval is not very long. And I want to mention this paper. So I found this during the preparation of this talk. It's of course in a different community, but it gives this new algorithm of computing correlation time functions in real on the fly and at somewhat lower cost. And perhaps this is something interesting to look at. The basic concept is to use locally time averaged correlation functions to approximate the real correlation function, but they somehow they can control the error and so on. So yeah, I think this is something interesting to mention. Right, so this method, the method one, has been published on the on this issue of the Pensacola newsletter, and then we have this nice figure. So now you are seeing the correlation function in different time intervals, and we then average over all those peaks to get the autocorrelation function. So now finally we come to some results. So this is for the isotropic turbulence at Reynolds number 20, and the forcing wave number is 5. Because this is isotropic, we can do a shear average over the correlation functions. And what you see here for the solid curve, it has a k minus 1 slope. This is really revealing the sweeping effect. Namely, those small eddies are advected by the mean flow, or not by the mean flow, but by the energy dominant eddy, which roughly has a velocity of root mean square velocity. So the time scale then will be proportional to k minus 1 instead of k minus 2/3, as would be predicted by the Kolmogorov theory. The difference is that we are measuring this correlation time in the lab frame, which is an Eulerian frame. Whereas this, if you do the calculation in a Lagrangian frame, which co-moves with the energy dominant eddy, you will see this minus 2/3 slope. So we can do the same exercise to rotating turbulence. Now we have four panels with increasing Coriolis number. And the Coriolis number is defined as the forcing wave number, as we want to exclude the effects from large scales, which we will have, because of rotation, we will have large scale vortices. So what we see here is that both slopes of the velocity and helicity correlation times are decreasing with increasing rotation rate. And at the largest rotation rate, we see the helicity correlation time becomes larger than the velocity correlation time. So in other words, increasing rotation rate, we can increase the scale separation between helicity and velocity fluctuations. One caveat here is that at large Coriolis number, the shear averaging is not really appropriate because it becomes really axisymmetric rather than spherical symmetric. So the next thing we do is we do an azimuthal average in Fourier space rather than shear average and see what is the pattern. So here is for one run. The first panel shows you in the Fourier space the correlation time of the velocity fluctuations as a function of the radial wave number and the vertical wave number. There is a dashed curve here, which shows you the forcing wave number. And you see it's relatively isotropic because this is at Coriolis number 0.16. Similarly, we do the helicity correlation time. Again, it's somewhat isotropic. And then we divide the two. We divide the helicity time by the velocity time. And we got the third panel here. Now here in the third panel, we are only showing the region where this ratio is larger or equal to one. So we want to highlight the region where we see scale separation between the two fluctuations. Okay, so this is for one run, and we have four runs. From left to right, we have increasing rotation rate. So let's just focus on the last row here. What we see here is an increase of area where this ratio between timescales is greater than one. And also, if you look at the legend here, you also see an increase of the maximal value of this ratio. So from 1.5 to 5 or 3, then finally to 6. It is also to see that we have different patterns of anisotropy in the velocity and the helicity fluctuations. For example, the first row, you see that coherent velocity modes are mostly along the xy plane in the Fourier space, whereas for the helicity, it is mostly along the z-axis. So we are seeing different directions, more or less, of anisotropy for the two fluctuations, and this is currently not understood. All right, so, and we also have volume average timescales. So the black curve is for the velocity timescale. It drops with increasing rotational rate. And for the helicity timescales, they both increase, either for the total helicity or for the helicity per wave number. Sorry, not per wave number, but the average timescale for each wave number. So this confirms that there is an increase in the helicity in the scale separation with increasing rotation rate. And next we go to shearing turbulence. So again, this is in the Fourier space, and this is at the ky equals zero plane. So this is a slice in the Fourier space without any kind of average. And all those calculations are done in the shear frame. I'm not going to talk about the details of this, but the rough idea is that this is the frame where all those fluctuations are spatially homogeneous, and that can validate the Fourier transform. Otherwise, in the lab frame, you cannot really do a Fourier transform in the x direction. So roughly, we see the same pattern as the rotation case, that we see an increase of the area where this ratio between timescales is greater than one. And also the patterns of anisotropy are different. For example, the last run here, which is shear dimensionless shear number at 2, you see more or less isotropic helicity timescale, whereas for the velocity, it's very different. And by the way, this subroutine shear frame transform allows you to do a shear frame to the shear frame transform to the quantities in the code. So then about the volume averaged timescales. Again, we see a decrease in the velocity timescale. But if you still remember, in the rotating case, we see an increase in the helicity timescale with increasing rotation rate. Whereas in this case, if you look at the dashed line here and the dashed red line here, they both decrease with increasing shear rate. So the trend is different as the rotating case. However, if you divide the time scales and get the ratio, they still increase. Although this effect is not as strong as the rotating cases. We reach a scale separation of about 3 for the total helicity and about 1.5 for the G quantity, which is the for each wave mode. Now we can do some mean field modeling using those results. So if you assume an isotropic alpha and use this double averaging technique, actually can derive a number for the maximal growth rate and that corresponding wave number. Here, eta alpha is tau alpha times the alpha fluctuation. So both, if you connect them to the helicity in the simulation, they are measurable quantities. Either you identify tau alpha with tau h or tau g, and also you identify this alpha RMS with helicity fluctuations times some velocity correlation time, the usual definition of alpha. So everything in this expression is measurable from simulations, and we can plot them as a function of the shear rate. And if you compute the slope, it's actually shallower, not shallower, but actually doesn't quite agree with what people measured from real dynamo simulations. And we think this suggests some additional ingredient in our modeling, for example, anisotropic alpha tensor, or the memory effect, or magnetic field. And I will mention this in more detail in the last slide. Right, so I see I'm kind of running out of time, so let me skip the turbulence case and go to the Keplerian case. So Keplerian, basically we add a rotation to the shear flow according to the 3/2 value. And what we see is a boost in the scale separation. For example, comparing this panel in the up and the third panel in the bottom. And you see a larger area in the Fourier space. So this is very likely due to this additional rotation in the flow. Again, if you look at volume average values, you see a boost. In the bottom, you see the purely shearing case, which has 3 and 1.4. And if you add a capillary rotation, it is boosted to 11 and 2.6 for the two values. So let me quickly summarize. What we did is we performed non-helically forced hydrodynamic turbulence. Both rotation and shear will increase the scale separation between helicity fluctuations and velocity fluctuations. If we simply assume that alpha is isotropic and do the double averaging, then we might conclude that the incoherent alpha effect is weak. However, we did not take into consideration several other ingredients. For example, the alpha tensor has to be anisotropic in shear flows. And the helicity time scale might not be so simply related to tau alpha. They might be connected through the memory effect, which means the dynamo process, the turbulent coefficients will depend on more on the history of the flow rather than like within one eddy turnover time. And this has already been the idea has been already be developed in those renovating flow models. And finally, this is a hydro simulation, and including the magnetic field might change the result. And it will be really interesting to see what happens in MHD simulations, especially with perhaps a small scale dynamo. Yeah, that's from my side.
Thank you very much. So anybody has any questions? So Axel already raised his hand. Axel, yeah.
Yeah, just a quick one about the shear frame.
Yes.
Is it actually then fully continuous when you switch somehow, right? After one revolution back to the original one, does it? Is it continuous in that step?
It's continuous,
yeah.
Yes.
It's continuous. Yeah. Right. Exactly. Great. Yeah. That's just what I wanted to confirm. Thanks. Very good talk.
Okay. So apart from the correlation time, so have you also kind of estimated the correlation scale of the velocity field in your hydro this thing runs? In the shearing turbulence case.
We didn't do that. But perhaps you can make some estimates from maybe by multiplying the velocity amplitude at that wave number by the wave number. Maybe we can do some estimates from that, but we didn't do the actual measurement of the length scale.
Okay. So any more questions? comments